All right, Psalm 115, verse 1. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory, for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. Wherefore, or another way to say it would be, why should the heathen say, where is now their God? But our God is in the heavens. He has done whatsoever he has pleased. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses have they, but they smell not. They have handles, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not, neither speak they through their throat. They that make them are like unto them, so is everyone that trusteth in them. O Israel, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. Ye that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord has been mindful of us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. The Lord shall increase you more and more, you and your children. You are blessed of the Lord, which made heaven and earth. The heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's, but the earth has he given to the children of men. The dead praise not the Lord, neither any that go down into silence, but we will bless the Lord from this time forth and forever. Praise the Lord. Praise God. We thank you, Lord, for your word that reveals truth to us. This morning, I meant to entitle my message, that God's not dead, he is alive. Amen. And I said I meant to because I forgot to put it on here, but at least I remember to tell you. God's not dead, he's alive. Amen. And his people need to know that. Praise God. His people need to know that God is not dead, but that he is indeed alive, and he's more than willing to work in our lives. It's been a while since I've done this, but I felt like I wanted to because we have a few new people. We used to do this all the time where we would write on the board kind of like a chronology of some special events that have taken place in the Bible so that we can kind of catch up to and understand where we are chronologically whenever we are at the teaching where we are today. I usually start off with the fall, not that creation is not important because it is, and we've talked a lot about it before, but the fall is where the plan of God moves into action for humanity. It's when the redemption, which means the buying back of the people of God, takes place. Because of the fall, man now has taken sin into himself. You and I need to understand that as the people of God who believe that God is real. We don't just believe just because somebody told us so, and this is a big part of my message this morning. We believe because we heard. He was real, but then he made it real to us. We heard a lot of people beforehand telling us that he was real. We heard words coming out of people's mouths. We might have seen preachers on television. If you were like me, I was at that place they call the Strip in Lafayette. My sister had already told me, but I'll never forget. I was standing out there. I was drunk. I was wasted doing whatever it was that I did, and some college kids showed up. And they tried to hand a religious tract to some of my friends that were before me. And my friends were like, dude, I don't want that. Get out of my face, laughing at them. And when they went to hand it to me, my sister had already told me about Jesus. She had already brought me to church. And I had already gone to church. I had already asked for prayer. I mean, you would have never known him looking at me like that at that point in time because I was a mess. But I took that thing and I stuck it in my pocket. And I can remember the next morning. I know I've shared this story before, but I'll never forget it. You know, and you should never get tired and bored with people's stories about how God intervened in their life, okay, because they were once dead, but now they're alive. And I can remember pulling that thing out of my pocket and reading it, and it was Jesus had blood streaming down his face, and it said, all this I did for thee. At that moment in time, something awakened. It didn't change everything right then, but something awakened. God was revealing himself to me, and much of what I want to talk to you about this morning has to do with that. Divine revelation. God does reveal himself to people. So when we start off at the fall, That's the issue that sin has entered into the human race and that it has separated the human race from the presence of God. That is the problem on the earth today. A thing called sin, born of Adam,
born with sin in us, born separated from God. It's not because your mama slept around and you got to see all of that growing up, and so now you see how men treated your mom, and so you hate men. It's not because your daddy drank too much and he verbally abused you when he came home. It's not because your first, your second, and your third husband treated you wrong and left you in a miserable situation. It's not because you drink too much or you do too many drugs. The problem is sin. Amen. All these things are connected to sin. Amen. And God is a God of healing. He's a God of healing. He's a God of mercy. Hallelujah. The psychologist ain't gonna fix you. The pill's not gonna do the trick. It's not gonna be the next man or the next woman that's gonna fill the void in your life. It's gonna be Jesus and Him alone. Nothing else. Amen. Your job's not gonna do it. Your hobby's not gonna do it. I don't care how much you like working out in the gym, how much time you spend there, how much good you think is done for you, that is not gonna fill the void in your life. It's to know the living, breathing, smelling, handling, walking God, the one that has hands that created the heavens and the earth, amen, that ministers to and moves and operates in the midst of people's lives. It started at the fall. Man, God, since that time, He clothed Adam and Eve with skins of an animal. That means He sacrificed an animal. It means their blood was shed. It means He was telling us beforehand that He had a plan, and the plan was going to include a sacrifice. Amen. And ultimately, we know, thousands of years later, that sacrifice was manifest in Jesus, the darling of heaven, the one who never sinned. He was from incorruptible seed, born of a virgin, and He died for you, and He redeemed you. What does that mean? He purchased you back through the shedding of His blood. Amen. And so we see the fall takes place, and then it's not long after that we see a flood. I mean, the earth was really bad then. You think it's bad now? It was really bad then. You understand? And God destroyed the whole earth because the thoughts of mankind were continuously wicked before the Lord. And so the flood takes place, and then not long after that we see that event called Babel. I noticed that we got some stuff in the mail this morning, some more teaching lessons for the kid, and one of them had to do with the main thing was about the Tower of Babel. I was like, oh, okay, that's cool. I want to read that. And so Babel is where we get to Babel. If you spell it B-A-B-B-L-E, it means just a bunch of, we call it in medicine, word salad. And somebody, unfortunately, if somebody has a stroke, sometimes they say words, but it just doesn't mean anything. It doesn't have any coherence to it. Blah, 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 blah. It doesn't, you don't understand. And so at that point in time, the whole earth was of one language, is what the Bible says. You know what's interesting? I don't mean to veer off too much because I don't want to say what I have to say. But you know, I'm going back and I research things because I just have to know. And sometimes I talk to smart people, you know, and I can remember talking to one of the brothers, Aunt Joan's son, the older one. He married a girl who was a linguist. That's her job. I mean, these are some smart people. They study languages. Well, I brought it up to her, and I don't think that she really refuted what I was saying, but I can remember going back and researching independently, can you prove that all languages come from one source? And, you know, there were two Russian linguists that actually did studies that say, we firmly believe that all languages came from one source. That's why the word carnal, which means flesh, is in Spanish, carne. Carne asada means flesh, and go on and go on. These kinds of words connect themselves to one another repeatedly like that, okay? And so, but they weren't even Christians. They were secularists. Half the time, the scientists, when they find things that actually support the Bible, they'll never tell you that it supports the Bible story because they don't want you to believe that it supports the Bible story because they want you to believe that the Bible is all a bunch of fiction. Nevertheless, the wickedness of man was still prevalent on the earth. And they all were all of one language, and they corporately came together to defy God. I got to tell you, the same spirit that caused this cohesion to come together to corporately defy God still lives on the earth today. Ephesians chapter 2 speaks of it. It's called the spirit of it's the spirit and the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan. And it's a spirit that works in the children of disobedience. That there's a majority of humanity that's being filtered or moved, herded in a specific direction, and it's in an opposite direction of God. Now, some of it is cloaked in or disguised by terms like religion.
There's people that will speak about God out of their mouth, but the reality of it is that they do not believe in the God that we're talking about. Oh, they might even say, I believe in the one who sent his son, Jesus, but they're not believing the gospel according to the way God wrote it. And they'll pick and choose parts of the Bible of what they want to believe and what they don't want to believe in order to tailor their own lifestyles to be able to live their lives in such a way that they choose to. But that's not the type of Christianity that we're in. I got to introduce you to that fact. We're not in that type of Christianity. We're in the type of Christianity that believes that the Bible is the living, breathing Word of God. The Theopneustos. God breathed Word. He breathed it in man, through man, for man. He has revealed Himself, His character, His Word, His will to man through His Word. That's how He wants to get to know you. That's how He wants to reveal Himself. We're talking about partly divine revelation this morning. He wants to reveal Himself to you through His Word. You'll come across people that, oh, well, I don't believe everything. Well, you got a problem. You have a problem because you're going to pick and choose and you're going to continue to live your own life. And, you know, I was sitting in a restaurant Friday and overheard these girls talking about the fact that obviously they were talking about this church in home, Bayou Blue Assembly. I know the pastor there because he interviewed me whenever I was certified, and he's like hardline, old school preacher, right? I mean, they got a kind of a nice sized church, but I mean, he don't play. I mean, does he preach the cross the way that I don't know about all that, but I do know this. He believes in living a separated life, and he don't mince words about it, buddy. And so they were sitting there at that table, and he obviously believes in evangelism. And he got one of his people that goes to his church that believes in personal evangelism, because she's over there. These two girls work together. I could kind of hear out of the side of my ear what they were talking about. And God didn't give me an opportunity to intervene. I was praying, but I really didn't feel peace about it. But anyway, this is basically what was happening. This old girl's been asking them two to go to church. And they were sitting there talking about how I ain't going to her church. Them people don't even go to parades. Them people don't go to parades. Them people, they don't do nothing, man. I'm not going. I told her, I'm Catholic, girlfriend. And I am not going to your church. You know, and so I started thinking to myself, that's what they think about us. Now, not always, it doesn't always work that way. There's many times whenever they down on their, and to be real, you don't even know what the personal conversations were with each one of them separately. You don't even know one of them might have gone to her. The other one might have gone to her at separate times whenever they wanted some answers. But then now that they get together, they want to clown her and talk bad about her. You know, I don't know what the whole scenario is. But what I'm trying to say is that the world does not understand the things of God, and that they're being driven in a direction that's opposite of God. That's what was happening at Babel. God confused their languages and caused them to go from one language to multiple, so it became a bunch of Babel. And from that point moving forward, God in the next scene, if you turn the page to the next chapter, called a man named Abraham out. From this, many nations were produced. Right? God caused mankind to spread over the earth. Oh, there's more that could be said about a lot of that. You know, I've done research on that to prove that, but we're not going to get into that right now. Many nations, but God called a man named Abraham out. And what did he tell Abraham? He said, I'm going to make you a nation. See, God made a nation for himself. Why did God do that? It's very important that you understand this. I know that this is a lot of information this morning, but God has always had a witness in the land. He's always had a light in the land. He wants to shine light. He wants a mouthpiece. God has chosen to use mankind. See, the world wants God just to float down in all His glory and reveal. God doesn't operate that way. You're going to believe Him according to His Word and the way He has chosen to reveal Himself, or you're going to choose not to believe Him. And you're only going to live your life for the things that you can touch, taste, smell, hear, and feel. And so, but God called a man named Abraham out, and he said, I'm going to make a nation out of you. And Abraham had a son named Isaac, and Isaac had two sons. The second one, the twin, was named Jacob, and Jacob's name was changed to Israel. There's a lot that can be preached in all of that, but I'm just trying to give you a basic understanding of where all this stuff comes from. You got to understand something. You turn on CNN or Fox News today, I say this a lot, but it means something. You will hear them talk about Israel. 2,000 years ago, God called a man named Abraham out
There was no nation called Israel. God created that nation for himself to be a mouthpiece.
During the time frame of Israel, you go through the judges, and then finally you enter a time frame known as the kings. There's a lot that could be said about all of that, but we're not really going to go there. From the kings, the first one was Saul, but the second one was David. That was the one God really wanted, King David. He's a type of Jesus. When we preach about David from the Old Testament, he's a type and a shadow. He's a foreshadowing of the coming king that will come. Jesus, ultimately, you can trace the lineage of Mary and also Joseph from King David. And that's a big connection to the plan of God. David had a son named Solomon with Bathsheba. Solomon became the king of Israel. Solomon failed God in a big way, and it caused a split in the kingdom. The split in the kingdom caused a northern kingdom known as Israel and a southern kingdom known as Judah, which is where Jesus ultimately came from, which is where David was ultimately from. And what all I'm trying to say is that the psalm that we're reading this morning comes somewhere in the time frame after this split, after Solomon has failed God, and now the heathen, the world around Israel, is saying, where is their God now? The God that delivered them, the God of miracles that they embraced, the God that we heard of in times past, where is he now? Where is this God that they say that they serve? And they mock them. The world around them mocks the people of God. They deride them. They laugh at them. They sneer at them. They roll their eyes. And they amuse themselves with the fact that there's a people that would really believe that God is real and that they choose to live their lives a specific way, but yet God doesn't even show up for them. And in the midst of all of that, God is, there was a time frame whenever God delivered them from Egypt, if you'll remember that. When God delivered them from Egypt and they showed up, just to use Jericho as an example, when the spies went into Jericho and they met with Rahab the harlot. You remember what Rahab said? We have seen and heard, or we have heard what you have done to the kings on the other side of Jordan. And we fear, they trembled. It says, the Bible says that Jericho was all shut up for the fear of the children of Israel. They had heard that they were coming that way. And they were fearful. The nations, the Gentile nations, were in awe of the nation of Israel and the God that they served. And they knew that they could not go up against this mighty nation. But now, all these years later, they're a topic of ridicule. They're a topic of mockery. And this psalm that we read this morning is in response to the way the world views God's people. But more importantly, God's people are concerned with the way that the world views their God because of their specific situation. And you know what? The same thing is happening in people's lives today. You've experienced it. If you've served the Lord for any length of time, you have experienced it more than once in your life where people look at your life, they look at your situation, and if they haven't said it to your face, and maybe they have, they've said it behind your back, why would I want to serve their God? Look at their life. Look at the things that's going on with them. Why would I want to serve him whenever he doesn't even... And if they really mean to you, they'll tell it to your face to try to beat you up and to try to make you feel bad. And the enemy will use it to cause you to begin to question, did I even make the right decision? Is God even really going to work, move, and operate in my life? You know, therefore, they praise him. Because of the situation, and the children of Israel realize that it's because of their situation that the heathen are mocking God, they choose to praise God. They choose to write a song to praise him anyway. Even in the midst of the circumstance, even in the midst of the bad situation, you know what? We're just going to praise him. We're going to exalt him. They praise God because he's worthy. And even though the circumstances in their life are not good, and it looks like God is against them, they take a play out of Job's book and they say, though he slay me, yet will I serve him. If you've ever heard the story of Job, if you've ever read the story of Job, the first day, the Bible says that Job was a man of God. He loved God. He offered sacrifice to God just based on the pretense, the thought, that his children could possibly sin against God. They were having a party down the road. All of his kids were together, having a party down the road. Job thinks in his heart, I don't know for sure every little detail of my kid's heart. And I just don't want to fail God. They're connected to me. I'm connected to God. Let me offer up some sacrifice just in case they mess up. And on that day, trouble wreaked Job's life. All of his children lost, his servants lost, cattle lost, and one thing after another. And it was all a test. Things are happening in the spiritual realm that Job can't see. Things are happening in the spiritual realm that you and I can't see. But yet everybody else in the physical realm looks at Job. They laugh at him. They mock him. His best friends mock him. And they deride him. And they say, you're going to serve this God? Even his wife says, you just need to curse God and die is what you need to do if this is the God that you serve. And many times that's what people believe in their heart and in their mind. But Israel, in this psalm, they probably remembered the life of Job. And Job refused. Instead, he would exalt the Lord. He would praise God, even in the midst of his service. Though he slay me, yet will I serve him. I don't know about you, but I hope and pray that that would be the cry of my heart. Amen. Though he slay me, yet will I serve him. No matter what the situations are, no matter what the circumstances are that I'm facing, that I'm going through, I would realize that God is sovereign, that he is love, that he is merciful, and that he is worthy. No matter what I experience, no matter what I see, God is still worthy to receive glory and honor. See, no matter what is seen by human eyes, heard by human ears, or touched by human hands, God is bigger than what is seen. And he reveals these truths to his people. The problem is that the world can't see. You understand that? I'm talking about divine revelation, a big part of it this morning. God is alive. He's not dead. He's alive. And he reveals himself. And the problem is that the world can't see what he has revealed to your spirit. I was talking to somebody out in the parking lot about that this morning. You don't leave the camp specifically to come to church on Sunday. If you don't know God, if you don't feel the presence of God, why are you going to leave the camp? I mean, it's pretty out there right now, I would imagine. Yeah. Unless you're just so wore out that you can't do no more work. But my point is that if you don't believe God is real, he's had to have done something to your life. I mean, I don't really speak that great. I mean, it's not like this is some entertainment show. There's other things that you could be doing. But if God reveals himself to you in a way that makes himself real to you, then guess what? We want to hear about the Lord. Amen. We want to sing about Jesus. We want to, hallelujah, experience what God would have to say. The problem is that the world can't see what he has revealed to your spirit, so you look silly to them. You look funny to them. Just as Israel was a mockery to the heathen around them. Point number one, God is alive and he reveals himself. Amen. God's people know that he's real, but they want the heathen to see what they see. We have to understand that this is a main separating point between the true followers of God and the people that don't really know him, and it's called divine revelation. I know I've said it multiple times. How do you even explain divine revelation? What a privilege, I was thinking when I wrote this. I wrote that little statement this morning. What a privilege to know that God is real. Do you realize how many people that you run into contact with on a daily basis? The people that you work with, the people that you used to go to school with, the people that you run into, well, I don't know, wherever you meet them. How many people cannot wrap their mind around the fact that God is real? Real enough that he wrote you a word, amen, that he desires for you to know him, and that if you will listen to his word and live your life according to his will, then there is a reward in the end. Not a picking and choosing, some cafeteria buffet line that I eat what I want, I don't eat what. No, he's made himself real enough to you to make you desire to do his will. It doesn't mean that you always get it right, but there's something on the inside of you that drives you forward to desire to be pleasing to God. God reveals himself to his people in a way that the world can't see, therefore, they are prone to mocking God. They can't see it. Half the time, they don't even really, really, really want to see it. How many times have you spent time trying to help people to see it? You know, I learned something from that book we've been studying on Sunday nights. In one of those chapters, I don't remember which one, but Christian is talking to somebody else, and the person's like, nobody else, your family didn't come with you? No. Well, you didn't tell them? Oh, yeah, I told them. I told him till, like, basically he didn't say it, but I told him till I was blue in the face. Well, yeah, okay, well, hold on. Did you pray for him? That one right there convicted me. Because I'll tell you how many times I've stood up here and I've said, if my kids go their own way, after I've taken the time that I took, so see, that sounds prideful already. After I took the time that I took to teach them the things of God, no, there ain't no black or white. I mean, gray, it's only black or white. And if they go that way, it'll be their own choice. And I did do that. But I don't think I prayed for them like I should. I don't think that I prayed for them. But Christian said, oh, I prayed. Oh, I prayed for them. But did you live your life in front of them in such a way that it wouldn't have deterred or messed up the revelation of God in their minds? And he said that he did, you know? But the point that I'm trying to make is this, is that the world, they can't see, and so therefore they are prone to mocking God. And there's many times that we have tried to help them see. And we should still continue to try to help them see. And I know that there's been times that I have spent hours trying to help people see, going around in circles, talking to them. They didn't really, I don't think that they really wanted to know. They really wanted to try to debate me. And I don't mean to be rude, but they didn't have enough knowledge to even talk about the first thing. Because they didn't even believe in the Bible. They didn't believe in the scriptures. But I can't say that I really prayed for those people like I should have. Psalm 115, verses 1 and 2. The children of Israel say in Psalm 115, verses 1 and 2, not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give glory, for thy mercy and for thy truth's sake. Wherefore should the heathen say, where is now their God? Point number one, God is alive and he reveals himself. These two verses speak to the occasion of the psalm. The people of God are being ridiculed by the world around them, and there are times in the lives of God's people that things aren't going well. God is a God of blessing, but he's also a God of testing. And sometimes when we're in the midst of the test, it's hard for us to remember how and when we were blessed. They make it clear that their main concern is how God is viewed by others. I thought, God really drove this home to me as I was reading this. Their main concern is how God is being viewed by others. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto your name give glory. So they're in the midst of a situation and a circumstance, and they're crying out to God. Don't get me wrong, they want deliverance from their circumstance. How many people, if you've ever been in a circumstance, you want to be delivered out of it, yet at the same time, they're cognizant enough to know that God's reputation is the one that's on trial here, and that whenever the world, this is important, it's important for us to understand that it's very easy for us to really miss the importance of literally what's going on whenever we're going through something. When we're going through something and the world around us is mocking us, we have it's very difficult for us to get out of the way it makes us feel about ourselves. You understand what I'm saying? Like we're very, even if we don't want to, even if we don't try to, it starts to beat us up. It starts to draw us down. It begins to try to oppress us. The enemy is using it as a tool to try to oppress us and to press us down. But it's important for us to remember that the God we vocally serve, the one that we speak of, he's really the one that they're calling into question. They're looking at our lives, our situation, our circumstance, and they're calling God into question. They see God as weak. So often we are so consumed with our own circumstances and the way we think, we look to the people around us that we forget how God looks to them too. The people of Israel realize this. They want out of their situation. But at the same time, they're like, for no other reason, God, give glory to your own name. Show up, deliver your people out of their situation, amen, so that you can be exalted, so that your name can be glorified. Israel's song to God was that he would vindicate himself through the rescue of his people. Yes, they wanted relief from their circumstances, but more importantly, God's good name was at stake. Therefore, they cry out, but unto thy name give glory. Don't let the heathen say, where is now their God? Yes, we need you, God, but for your own name's sake, come down and heal your servant, confound the mind and shut the mouths of your enemies. God reveals himself to his people in a way that the world can't see. Therefore, they are prone to mocking God. But look at the gods that they serve. They want to mock your God. They want to look at your situation and they want to mock you for serving your God. But look at the gods they serve. Look verses 3 through 8 in Psalm 115. But our God is in the heavens. He has done whatsoever he has pleased. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. You need to pay attention to that. They have mouths, but they speak not. Eyes have they, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses have they, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. They that make them are like unto them. So is everyone that trusteth in them. I mean, just real quick, those gods are dead. God is not dead, he is alive, but the gods of these people of the world are dead, and the people that serve them and make them and look to them are dead too. That was point number two. The gods of the world are manufactured by men. The gods of the world are manufactured by men. They look like living things, but they're dead. I want you to be aware of that. Because this is still true today. The gods of the world are manufactured by men. In other words, they take their hands and they make their gods. And they look like it's living to the natural eye. It looks like living, but in reality, it's dead. Sub point number one. The true God is the sovereign creator. He isn't made by man's hands. His hands made man. Amen? That's what it said in verse 3 of chapter of 115. But our God is in the heavens. He has done whatsoever he has pleased. Well, we're contrasting their God to our God now. And the first thing we need to understand about our God is this, is that his true followers, the true people of God, they understand some things. That no matter what happens or how things look, God is sovereign. He's in heaven, we're on earth. He's the one that's orchestrating circumstances. He cares about you. You need to understand that. I can remember one time we went to a revival in Pensacola, and we stayed at this helicopter pilot's house, and he had been dabbling into some kind of different kind of doctrine. And I said, well, I didn't even know anything about the Bible then, but I knew what he was saying wasn't right. I'm like, you don't think that God's real? Oh, of course I think God's real. I just think that he created us, he put us down here, and then he just left us to ourselves. What I need you to know is this, is that God's people understand. Because he felt like God was uncaring. He had been to Vietnam. He had seen atrocities. He had seen things that happened. And how could a good, loving God allow things to happen? Listen, the fall caused a curse. There's death and dying and pain all around us. The true people of God understand that God allows circumstances. That no matter how things look in the physical, God is sovereign and he's still in control. He's in control of your life. Don't be like that man and think, so many bad things are happening to me. God must not love me. No, he loves you. He loves you. He loves you so much he sent his only son to die for you. It doesn't mean that everything is going to go the way you want it to on this earth. Amen. But God wants you to continue to look to him, to trust in him. And when you cry out to him about your circumstance, why don't we learn to throw that up there every now and then? Lord, not unto us, but unto your name be given glory. Yes, rescue your servant. Show up and pour your blessings down upon me. Change my situation. Return unto me the joy of my salvation. Give me your strength. But through it all, I pray that you would lift me up, that you would help me to rise up, and that your name would be given glory. That the very one that mocked you would now realize and be convicted in their heart that God, the God I serve, does show up and that he is real, and that you would even reveal to them the things in their life that are separate from you, that are contrary to you, and that their life is not what they think that it is. That's the prayer. God, reveal yourself to the heathen that they would know that you are real. The true people of God understand that no matter what happens, God is sovereign and in control. If things happen to his people, then it's because he allowed it. While the people may not be able to see the purpose now, they understand that God loves his children like a parent. I mean, this is about the best analogy we can get. If your parent didn't love you, then don't use this analogy, because God loves you. Amen. But like a parent loves their child, God loves us. And his purposes are always beneficial for us. He wants good for us. He knows what's best. Yeah. Well, God does the same thing for you. He's in the heavens. We're on earth. He's in control. We're not. Therefore, his people call on his mercy and truth, and they expect him to move. He may not always do it the way you want him to or when you want him to, but move he will. I can assure you, God will move in your circumstances. It may look completely different than the way you ever expected it to be. Whatever it is you're crying out to God for, right? But whenever it's all said and done, when you look backwards on it, you're going to realize, you know what, this was the Lord. I was wanting something else. I was asking for something else, but it really wasn't God's will, what I was asking for and what I was wanting. But this is God's will. God showed up. And if I would have just been listening a little more closely, then I would have realized it. Point, sub-point number two, under the fact that they manufacture their own gods, but that their gods are dead, is this. They manufacture their own gods. Verse 4. Their idols are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, they speak not. Eyes they have, but they see not. They have ears, but they hear not. Noses have they, but they smell not. They have hands, but they handle not. Feet have they, but they walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. The true God reveals himself through divine revelation in many ways, but the gods of the world are made by the hands of men. There's an emphasis on this passage that speaks of the features of the false gods. These features are similar to human features, right? Eyes, nose, ears, mouth, hands, feet. These features look like living things. They mimic human attributes that humans that are alive. But they can't speak, they can't see, they can't hear, talk, smell, or work. They can't go anywhere unless they are carried. So they look like life, but in reality, they're dead. You know, in today's society, people aren't, I'm not saying that nobody's worshiping false statues, but the reality of it is that an idol is something that stands in between you and the presence of God, stands between you and your relationship with God, something that you look to and you put all your focus on and all your emphasis of your daily life into, and it's not really the Lord. And those heathen out there in the world, those, what I mean by heathen is those that don't know God. I'm not trying to beat them up, trying to not make them sound bad. They just don't know God. They have not been divinely revealed to. When you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ that says that you were born a sinner of Adam, that God has a plan, and the plan was that he would send his son. That's what he did, creating Israel. And ultimately, I never got to that, but through Jesus, through Judah, what did he do? He gave us Jesus, the Savior of the world. So even all the way back here with the fall and the skins that he provided for Adam and Eve, which was the first sacrifice, he ultimately brought it forth. His plan was fulfilled. He gave us Jesus. He gave us the sacrifice. Amen. And he, through that, when you hear that gospel message, you may not have understood all of this. That's the miracle working power of God. The first time I ever went up, or the time that I went up to the altar when I was 19, and I gave my heart to Jesus, I didn't know anything about the Bible. But I know one thing. I stood up, I felt different than I did when I knelt down. I was different. There was a weight of oppression, like cement sacks that I'd been toting around, and bam, they fell off. And let me tell you, the enemy's tried to put them back on my back since, but it ain't never felt the way that it felt like it was before that day of conversion. And that's how God divinely reveals himself. When you give your heart to Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of your heart, you will never be the same again. And so while we would probably agree that most people aren't making little statues to worship, they're manufacturing things with their own hands. And they're worshiping these things that they're manufacturing with their own hands. And these things are really becoming their gods. They worship their careers. They look at all of the things that they've accomplished in their lives, whether it be the education that they've gotten. You know, I got a lot of education too, but guess what? You know what Paul said? It's a bunch of dung. It's a pile of dung. Everything that this world has to offer, I'm glad I went to school. I'm going to be honest with you. I used to swing a hammer in a pipe yard or offshore working on a hydraulic unit. I can swing a hammer with the best of them, working in the heat, But you know what? Filthy, nasty. I mean, listen, if you got to work in an oil field, I made decent money. I got to go to Norway. I got to go to Holland. I got to see the world. I went to Venezuela. I made good money. I'm not saying anything. But I'm going to be honest with you. Can I just be real? I know this is weird, but I got tired of having folliculitis all over my stomach. What is that? It's like a bad pimple rash from all that hydraulic oil that was always in my coveralls and all over my belly. I got tired of my feet having this rash from the rubber boots that I had to wear because of the chemicals that I was working around. And I'm glad I went to school. I'm glad I don't have to swing a hammer in the middle of the sun. If I'll run in the sun. I'll do exercise in the sun because I don't want to get too soft. But at the same time, if I can help it, I don't want to work out there. And if I have to, I can, but I don't want to. I'm glad I went to school. I'm not ashamed that I went back to school and now I make more money than I did before. I'm not. And I'm going to tell people that come to this church, if you're struggling to find a job, and sometimes people are, then guess what? You need to separate yourself from the crowd. You need to find some kind of a trade, some type of something that you can do that separates you from the crowd. We got people in here that are pipe fitters. We got people that know how to weld. Not everybody can fit pipe and weld. So therefore, we got people that know how to consult on certain things. So therefore, they're separated from the crowd. But what I'm trying to say is this. You can't look at your accomplishments and the things that you've done and you begin to elevate yourself because of what you've accomplished. And that's what the world in today's society does. They look at these things, their whole focus, their whole attention is on their careers, their social lives, on their material possessions, the houses that they live in, the cars that they drive. These things, like those idols that had eyes, noses, mouths, and hands, they look like living, but in reality it's dead. When you look at it from the outside, it's like, oh, they're really living now. Sometimes I jog through neighborhoods, like at home I used to jog, boy, like, this is a nice neighborhood, look at that house, boy. You know, and even me, I'm like, boy, these people are really living right here. No, you don't know what's going on inside that house. And if they don't know the God that we know, they aren't living at all. It's dead. What they're living is dead. They are separated from the presence of God. And yet at the same time, we get caught up in this spirit that's driving people in a certain direction. And we find ourselves being moved and altered off of course because we want to have what it is that they have. Listen, trust God. Be faithful. Move forward. Take care of your business, right? Spend your money the right way. And you might be able to afford to have some nicer things if that's God's will for your life. But that's not living. And it's certainly not supposed to be your God. These idols and these things can't watch over you with a watchful eye. They can't speak to the storms of life when ready and say, peace be still. All these attributes of these false gods, they are representative of things that God can do. Like, in other words, the nose and the eyes and the ears of the false gods can't do anything. But God, he can do. His hands created the universe. Certainly they can work on your behalf. Amen. His mouth spoke creation. Certainly he can speak change or blessing in your life. Amen. He is omnipresent, meaning he don't even need feet because he's everywhere. God is everywhere at every moment and every time. There is no place his feet can't bring him. There's no place that you are that he doesn't see and can't rush to your defense. All of those are attributes of God, but I got to be honest with you, I wanted to focus on one attribute, his nose. I wanted to focus on the nose. And the reason why I want to do that, and that's subpoint number three, their gods are dead, they manufacture with their hands, but our God's alive. The reason I want to function on the nose is I want you to understand something. You are a living sacrifice for your God, and he has hands and feet to carry you through. What does that have to do? What does his nose have to do with a living sacrifice? People work so hard for those gods. They sacrifice everything, their career, their social life, their material possessions. But those things cannot smell the sweet savor of your life of sacrifice. Those things can't recognize anything that you've ever done for them. They're just dead, inanimate. They're going to burn up when this earth burns up. There's not going to be anything left to them. God has a nose that he can smell the sweet savor of sacrifice. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 through 16. You are a living sacrifice for God. It says, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ. 2 Corinthians 2:14 through 16. Now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ, and makes manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved, and in them that are unsaved, that are in them that perish. We're talking about the knows, or we're talking about a living sacrifice. Look at verse 16. To the one, we are the savor of death. That's to the ones that perish. And to the other, we are the savor of life. That's to the ones that are saved. To the unbeliever, you taste like death. Can I tell you that? They can't see. They can't understand what you're doing. Your whole life and everything you stand for irritates them. It looks like your life is death, not life to them. And to the other, the savor of life unto life. But to the believer, when they see you do it the way God says to do it, it makes sense and it offers hope of life. When other believers see believers living for God, even in the midst of their trial and their tribulation and their circumstances, hopefully we'll start to learn to take notice of the fact that I'm not the only one going through something here, but there's other people that are going through things. And guess what? They're still desiring to serve God. They're still calling on the Lord. They're still showing up, they're still serving him, even though things aren't going the way that they want them to. And guess what it does? It should bring hope and it should bring life to you. Paul had been treated wrongly by some in the Corinthian church. That was the occasion of this letter that I wrote. When he said, we're a sweet savor, a sweet smelling savor unto the Lord through Christ. He had been treated wrongly by people in the Corinthian church. And one of the main reasons he wrote this letter was to let the Corinthian Christians know that he forgave the offender. He was writing a letter to say, hey, I've forgiven him. And he said, you should too. There is no way around it. When you are treated wrong and forgive, you act like Jesus and reveal him to the world. I know it's hard to act like Jesus when people are treating us wrong. Nevertheless, God wants to do a work in our heart to where it's not just us faking it, but that it's really him doing
right.
It through us. Amen?
Amen?
Yeah. Praise God. Yeah, that's right. That's right. And it gives him glory.
Yeah.
Sometimes we try, oh, I know the right thing, but guess what? I ain't about to do it right now. But you know what? If your heart desires to love the Lord, and I know it is, then guess what? He will do it to where it's real.
Yeah.
To where you have a peace. And no matter what they do to you, no matter how they treat you, guess what? He will come to your aid and he will be your help. Paul's life was a sacrificial offering. He was well pleasing to God, the course of his life and proclaiming God's message, while at the same time suffering rejection and attack by many, was an extension of Jesus' life as the servant of God. The smell of a savor in the nostrils of God is connected to the Old Testament sacrifice. Leviticus 1 verses 8 through 9. It says, in the priests, Aaron's sons shall lay the parts. That's talking about the parts of an animal. They cut it all up, and they're going to lay it on the altar. The head and the fat in order upon the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. But his inwards and his legs shall he wash in water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. You and I are supposed to offer our lives as a living sacrifice to God. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. This is the Apostle Paul again. He says, I beseech you, Romans chapter 12, verse 1, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. We're talking about the knows, the fact that God smells, and what he smells is a sweet-smelling savor of a sacrifice. What I need you to know is this: a sacrifice goes through the fire. That's part of a sacrifice. You lay it on the wood. The wood is lit, and it's on fire, because fire represents judgment, and for the Christian, it represents the trials of life. A sacrifice goes through the fire, and that's how the sweet savor ends up in the nostrils of God. It is produced as you continue to serve him on this earth, no matter what you're going through. Even though people are treating you wrong, You're crying out to him and you're saying, you, Lord, may glory be given to your name. And as you're going through it, you can be sure that he will be there to hold you. And you don't have to worry about carrying him around because he will carry you when you can't walk.
That's right.
Amen. I thought about this poem. I'm sure everybody's probably read the poem before. Footprints in the Sand.
Yeah.
Been a while since I read it, but I mean, I'm going to read it again. I dreamed I was walking along the beach with the Lord. Across the sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand. One belonging to me, the other to the Lord. When the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that many times along the path of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I also noticed that it happened at the very lowest and saddest times in my life. This really bothered me, and I questioned the Lord about it. Lord, you said that once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I have noticed that during the most troublesome times in my life, there is only one set of footprints. I don't understand why. When I need you most, you would leave me. The Lord replied, my precious child, I love you and would never leave you. During your times of trial and suffering, when you see only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. One of the things that you can know is this, that no matter how bad it is, no matter how hard it is, sometimes you won't even be able to feel the presence of God the way that you used to. You got to believe, you got to keep trusting that God is with you, amen. He's there with you.
Amen.
And he's that the enemy's trying to turn you away from God. He's trying to get you to look and focus your eyes somewhere else. But I'm encouraging you this morning. I'm encouraging myself this morning. Stay focused on the Lord. Amen. Keep your eyes on him. And he will carry you through. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Psalm 115 verses 9 through 15. We're going to close with this. Starting in verse 9. O Israel, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. Ye that fear the Lord, trust in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. The Lord has been mindful of us. He will bless us. He will bless the house of Israel. He will bless the house of Aaron. He will bless them that fear the Lord, both small and great. The Lord shall increase you more and more. You and your children, you are blessed of the Lord, which made heaven and earth. Basically, whenever they would say this psalm, they would say, O Israel, trust thou in the Lord. He is their help and their shield. And then they would return and say, the people would say, O house of Aaron, trust in the Lord. And then the people would say, he is their help and their shield. And they would go back and forth like that. But what I need you to know is that it's talking about the house of Aaron, which means the priestly, the priest, the specific priest that did all the work. They were the ones that were recognized as the leaders of the society. But then when it says Israel, it's talking about the nation. Then when it says those that fear God, it's talking about people that were of other nations that chose to live for the God of Israel. It's talking about from the biggest to the smallest that serve God. In other words, it's not just the preacher, it's the people. It's not just, sometimes we look at certain people, oh, God might work for them, but he's not going to work for me. That's not how God sees things.
Amen.
God's no respecter of persons, amen? He wants to move from the biggest to the smallest, and he wants to be, he talked about he is their help and their shield. Help means aid. There's times in your life, you know, you ever see, I just got this vision, I didn't think of this earlier, but whenever you're broken, right? Whenever you're beat up, things are going, somebody get a first aid kit and they'll come to the rescue to try to bandage things up. Spiritually, what we need to understand is that in the spirit, we might look like we're all bandaged up.
Yeah.
Got a bandage on our head, we're bleeding, we're beat up. Well, you need to understand something. God is your aid, amen. He's the one that's coming to comfort. He's the one that's coming to help, amen. But not only that, he's your shield. Shield is talking about protection. He is your aid. He is your defense. Sometimes we're trying so hard to defend ourselves. When the world around us is mocking, when the world around us is saying what it is that they have to say, sometimes it's just best to, by the grace of God, shut our mouth. Because you're not, have you ever, you know the people that you can, that you've talked to before, just think in your head, maybe when you leave, if you have some time, about people that you've talked to before that kind of didn't really believe, but then at some point in time they were like, man, that was pretty good what you said right there. Have you ever experienced anything like that? Just at least once, hopefully. If not, you're not talking to enough people. But it's okay. You know, the Lord, you'll get there. All right. But have you also talked to people and you go around in a circle? I mean, like, it's like a dog on a chain and all the grass in the yard is dead. You're just going in a circle. You ain't getting nowhere with this old boy. You ain't getting nowhere with this old girl. You done learned that. Why you keep going back? At some point in time, it's best just to let the Lord be your defense. And say, God, please, help me just to shut my mouth. And for your own name's sake, give your name glory. Show up and do something, Lord. Give your name glory. I pray for this heathen that doesn't know you. I don't want bad stuff to happen to him, but I pray that you reveal yourself to him. Make yourself real, because I can't make it real. I've done what I know to do. Lord, I need you to show up. God is no respecter of persons. From the smallest to the biggest, he will protect them. The psalmist speaks of Israel, the nation, the house of Aaron, the priesthood. He speaks to them that fear him, that recognize him as God. The point being made is that God will take care of all his people. From the biggest to the smallest, you can trust that God will show up and he will bring aid to you. He will show up and he will be your defender. The problem is that I'm always wanting to defend myself. I feel like I've just done such a good job through the years. And you know, but so much has happened to me in the last couple of years. I know people that know, they may say, oh, you're no different. In the last couple of years, I'm telling you, I have learned just not to have to confront every situation. Not to have to even make a comment about every situation. I can actually just keep my mouth shut and be perfectly fine with it. Because I know that there's times, I'm telling you, Friday night, when I was sitting by them two women, I wanted so bad to interject. And I kind of looked at that one woman that was closest to me at the corner of my eye, and I saw the look on her face, and I said, I know it was the Lord. If you go there, she is going to be offended. You broke into her little night that she was spending, and I could just see it all over her. It was oozing out of her. And I felt like the Lord was saying, you do this when you're on your own. And I was like, I don't even have to go there. I don't have to do it. And there's freedom in that. I don't have to try to defend myself and argue every point anymore. But boy, I tell you, a couple of years ago, I just felt like I had to fix everything, confront every situation, argue every... No, he's the defender. Amen? And he knows how to defend himself. God wants to give increase to his people. And one of the last things that he said in that passage was, he talked about the children of God. He wants to give his people increase, and he wants to also give increase to their children. I just wanted to close this morning for people in here this morning that have children. I wanted to close by just saying a prayer for the kids.